All right, you're very welcome along to the Shot Clock, where we take aim at the biggest stories in sport. The rules are pretty simple. We get 8 talking points, 2 minutes each, and at the end of it, we try and keep score. Or maybe we don't. Kieran Donaghy is here. The rules are fairly simple. We understand them, right?
Yeah, we do, yeah.
There's a basketball hooter at the end of this, and you're supposed to shut up, but we'll see if we've met
it. If I can keep you quiet.
Exactly. We'll see if we've done it. So we're going to start with the first one. Ready, steady, go. Praise makes you weak. This was something that Billy Vinopola said to our reporter in the aftermath of the Ireland-England game.
It's the best thing about it is that we stay grounded, keep improving, and hopefully we can put out a performance, a similar performance to what we did. You know, in the week about praise making you weak, which is why I keep saying it's very, very important that we stay grounded.
Stay grounded, all right, as they absolutely pummeled Ireland. Praise does make you weak, and this is a point that the Real Madrid fans know and the Kerry fans know better than any other fan base in the world. If you go to Real Madrid and you lose 2 or 3 games in a row, immediately the white hankies come out and they start whistling you, irrespective of whether or not you're Cristiano Ronaldo with all your Champions League in your back pocket or whoever you are. That's what happens. It's the same in Kerry, the roughest type of fucking animals. That's what Potty said, and he was right. And that's why Kerry win everything all the time. The Mayo fans, they love their team through thick and thin and thin and thin. And the Liverpool fans, they love their team through thin and thinner. Which is the correct way here? It's the praise. It's the overburdened love. It's the maternal instinct. You want a hard dad. You want some tiger parenting like you guys got from the Kerry fans. Praise makes you weak.
It does. There's no doubt about it. We talked about it last week. I always wondered about that, you know, that, you know, if we ever came back after losing in All-Ireland, absolutely, we get it in the neck. That's the way it is in Kerry. You get the praise too when you win it, but you're as close to patting the back as a kick up in the arse in Kerry. But, you know, other counties, you see them, they lose, they come back, they're still, you know, the welcome is big. Even their fans turn up in bigger numbers the year after, they keep coming back again. So it is a huge thing. And, you know, speaking of the English rugby team, you know, they go out and lose to Wales at the weekend. So it's trying to keep yourself on that level playing field and try and keep yourself as an athlete right in the middle, where no matter what the results are going, that you're not getting too high or too low on yourself, because
England were the best team in the world according to the English media in the aftermath of their 2 excellent performances. You know, they killed us, fair enough, but it turns out we're not playing very well.
Yeah, no, exactly. And like, you know, I wouldn't be worried if Ireland play England down the road, and you know, we're not where we're supposed to be yet. And I think that's no harm along with the Irish rugby. I think, you know, I heard Johnny Sexton saying, look, we're trying to work on a few things. I never minded that when I was in with Kerry, when you weren't flying all year. You know, when there was a bit of a rough patch, it's no harm. It keeps everybody level, and it keeps you trying and working really hard to get there. So that's what Ireland will be hoping to do.
I think Billy Vinopola is right. We should all channel our inner Real Madrid fan.
Yeah, next up, Doug Howlett seen on the sideline for the Cork Hurlers last weekend, getting involved in a high-performance role. I think it's a great move by Cork, but some people don't.
Is it a bit of a cut after that? Is it really going to change how you are from one day to the next based on a conversation with someone who was successful in a professional sport?
Yeah, and you know how hurling people are a little different as well and can see through, how should we say, see through, not bluffers or anything like that, but he can't give them
That's
advice
about
hurling.
That's possibly the most snobbish thing we've ever had.
Yeah, could well be, but they can't give them any technical advice, and hurling is such a technical game. I just imagine it would be things to do with their lifestyle, maybe goal setting, maybe he's doing a bit of psychology as well. You wouldn't know. I'd say it's just kind of being the best you can be, would say, off the pitch. A lot of those kind of things tend to, successful people tend to say the same thing.
Like, for me, having Doug Howlett involved, I always loved it. We'd often go to training camps, we'd get Paul O'Connell to come into his Ron O'Gara. Players talking to you that have been there at the very highest level, and we can consider ourselves at a high level in the GAA, but getting somebody in from a level that's even higher is and a professional level and a background, I used to love picking their brains. You know, I think we're quite ignorant to think that we can't learn off other sports. I've seen firsthand, being involved at a high level in basketball, bringing some of that stuff to the football team and how it could help both a club or county. So I think there's always stuff to learn, and the high performance is one thing, but I'm sure Doug will spot things. Like, he's in Ireland a good few years, he's watched games. I'm sure he'll spot things that he might just be able to tweak a player on how he goes for a ball or what he sees.
2 things. The lads are putting the knob in hurling snob, and John Myler has like got personal experience from his son of watching high performance over a long period of time. So he knows the value that you can have from a professional environment and the little bits that you can steal from that. So of course, if he thinks somebody like Doug Howlett can come in and just have a quiet word with 3 or 4 people and just get three or four people to be leaders and to be better leaders, then that transforms the culture of the team really quickly.
Yeah, and like all an all-time All Black try scorer coming in, like that's as good as you're going to get from a guy that's going to give a young fella a nugget of information on how to get ready for a big game, or he might spot a guy being tense, or might spot a guy being off the ball and spot a guy being too relaxed before a game. And you know, it's the team environment is crucial, and I think the All Blacks epitomise team environments. So, you know, Cork beat Limerick the weekend, you know, they have a lot of good hurlers, they're there, thereabouts. We don't know what way the hurling is going to go. There's six or seven teams out there that can realistically challenge for an All-Ireland. So, you know, John Myler is doing a great job by looking for every little inch and seeing what he can pull from another sport that might help them out and try and get Cork to the promised land, because the football isn't going too good for them. So hurling has to be big on the agenda.
We'll get to the footballers in a little while. So our next point here is Mayo. I hate to say I told you so, but I told you so last week that there was no way that Mayo, who have one of the best kick-out strategies in the country, were going to reveal their hand this early on in the season. It makes no sense for Mayo to come up to Croke Park and to do all the things that they're going to do later on in the year. Why the hell would you give this Dublin team and their massive backroom team the opportunity to get some tape at this stage of the year? Sure, a lot of the best Mayo players were playing and didn't have their best ever games in Croke Park. But do we really need to see Aidan O'Shea and Andy Moran and Boyle and Keegan playing their best football at this time of the year? No, we don't. We need Mayo to make sure that those players get some football into their legs, get a bit of fitness and start realising what it is that the challenge that they face is. Everybody thinks I'm talking nonsense here, that Mayo had to come and beat the Dubs and put it up to them.
Of course they did. Like, what can you hide? Oh, we're going to push up in the kick-out. They've been pushing up on kick-outs for years. Dublin know how to counteract that. What tactic are Mayo going to do now that they're not going to do in the summer? There's not much to it. You have to go for the juggler. You have a chance to get to a league final. You have a chance to put another bit of doubt, just plant that seed of doubt in Dublin's heads that there might be just wavering a small bit and that hunger mightn't be there and that everybody else is starved out of their mind for this All-Ireland that's going to come up in the summer. A chance, a really good chance, and just disappointed because I thought Mayo were moving really well, and I've been a part of dressing rooms for 14 years in football, and I've never once gone out with a Kerry jersey on my back and said, "Oh, we won."
No, I'm not saying that either. I'm not saying that they went out. I'm not saying that they threw that game or anything. If you're the management, are you actually really going to start saying, "Well, you guys beat them in the league final in Croke Park. Is that the last time they lost a game in Croker?
Yeah.
Didn't do you any good that summer in the championship, did it?
No, we didn't even get a crack at them.
There you go. So I just think that if you're going to beat them once. Wait until it matters.
Yeah, I would have liked to have got a crack at them later on that year though, because, you know, some of the stuff that we did, and they would of course countered it, but we learned from that game too. You know, you have to learn from both winning and losing. You always learn more from losing, but you learn stuff from winning as well. And if you beat a team and certain stuff has worked, you can certainly look to go at it again. So, yeah, I thought they missed a big chance to really stake a claim on.
Lulling them into a false sense of security.
Maybe. You might be proved right later on in the summer.
We're going to get cocky thinking, should we have the measure of these guys?
I hope we don't have to come back to this VT and be proved wrong. Zion Williamson, college superstar with Duke University. The most explosive basketballer to ever come out of college. All the shoe companies will be looking for this guy. He's the next LeBron. He's the next Michael Jordan. A freak of nature. Happens to blow out his shoe in the biggest game in college basketball that was on last Wednesday week. Sock came straight out of the shoe. Nike will be disgusted. I'd say Reebok and Adidas and Under Armour are probably having a party looking at that. This kid is the future, and Duke are in a bit of trouble with him now, and a lot of NBA guys have come out since and kind of said, you know, if you're that good and you're kind of ready for the NBA, just don't go to college for a year, yeah, because there's an 18, 19 year old rule in there now where kids like Kobe and LeBron that went straight from high school into the NBA, they don't want that anymore, they want this. That's why you see so many of these college players having a one and done where they go for 1 year and then go straight into the NBA. A lot of the top guys now have come out and said, don't go to college at all because you're risking an injury. If you blow out your knee, all of a sudden your draft pick goes down, you mightn't be able to come back from it, a bad injury, an Achilles rupture, anything like that. So it's a really tricky one. And, you know, for these college guys, like, they're superstars. You know, when we were playing football with Kerry 2006, 2007 in All-Ireland Finals, our Americans used to come over at the start of the Garvey's Tigers years, and our guys used to be in there, and I'd say, oh, we've got a game in Dublin on Saturday, do you want to come up? Oh yeah, or Sunday, do you want to come up? And these guys land on and they kind of come away going, you know,
it was a big game.
What are you getting paid? Yeah, it's an All-Ireland final, there's 90,000 there, there's the Erasmus. What are you guys getting paid? Oh, we're not getting paid at all. And it's very like that for the college guys. So they're kind of risking a lot for nothing.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a big debate at the moment. Should these top high school players just wait a year?
Yeah, or start getting paid. That's the solution here. And there's loads of money sloshing around. They could all be getting paid a decent amount.
Yeah, exactly. They're getting their scholarships and they're getting that. And then, you know, you can't pay every collegiate athlete. So there is definitely a... You know, but I think the guys that are bringing money into certain schools, like the tickets for this game were going for $2,500 Super Bowl prices for tickets for a college game in Duke last Wednesday. So, like the money they're bringing to the college, there has to be a way to look at getting, maybe spreading it out to them.
All right, next one is Motion 39, the Dubs at Croker. What the hell is going on? Why can we not just have a competition that's fair from the start of the year, that everybody knows the rules? We're all going to have exactly the same situation. It makes no sense. The whole notion that there was this opportunity for Congress to have a vote, and because they didn't like the wording of it, they just throw it out. It's absolutely ludicrous. It means that this year, Dublin are going to have a massive advantage. We know that home advantage in all sports matters. It particularly matters in GAA against the Dubs because they play their league games there. And we've seen already in the league, they've lost two away games, they've won their two home games. It's not a coincidence. Being at home matters in sport. And the GAA had the opportunity to make the competition their biggest, most important competition, the one that drives all the revenue, that inspires all the kids to go and play. They had the opportunity to fix it and they didn't take it, and shame on them for doing it. I've got nothing else to say about this. It makes no sense.
Yeah, it makes no sense. And I think it kind of was almost maybe brought up wrong. I think you were never going to get their home games taken out of Croke Park. But what should have happened, I feel, is that the neutral venue games should not be in Croke Park. That means Dublin would have Croke Park as their home game, which is their home venue. Let's face it, we can say Parnell Park all we want. Croke Park is the home venue for the Dubs. They'd have an away game, and their neutral game should be in a neutral venue. And I think it's taken the spot, it's taken the, what it's like to play in Croke Park is special, and to be playing there every second week and in qualifiers and quarterfinals is a bit much. That's the game we played in the Gaelic grounds, an All-Ireland semi-final taken out of Croke Park. We played in Croke Park with 60,000 the week before. It was a good atmosphere, it was a good buzz, it was a good game, it finished level, there was a lot of drama. But nothing like the replay. 50,000 crammed into the Gaelic grounds, people getting in all sorts of ways. You couldn't beat that for an atmosphere. Kerry in Dublin in Semple Stadium back in 2001, the Morris Fitz Pint. You know, bring the flasks of tea, bring the sandwiches, everybody get to a neutral venue that you get 30,000 or 40,000
in. What's the difference between in a small neutral venue or small provincial venue versus a half-full Croke Park?
A half-full Croke Park, there's nothing worse. A third-full Croke Park is as dead as you can be. 30,000 in Croke Park versus 30,000 in a Nolan Park or, you know, one of these stadiums is just no comparison. It'd be great for the revenue in the communities. It'd be great to bring big football games to areas that mightn't see football games. We're trying to promote football in some hurling counties. Bring it down there. Bring both teams an hour and a half away. If people don't want to go an hour and a half away to see a big game between two very good sides, that's their tough. But I would certainly look at bringing all neutral games out of Croke Park. Leave Dublin have their home games there, leave them go for their away games and the neutral venue games in between grounds. It'd be way better.
The worst part about this is that Croke Park knew that there was an issue with this. They knew that the wording that Donegal proposed wasn't going to get forward and they did nothing about it. They could have intervened at any point along the way and they didn't. So they decided to let the whole situation roll over again. Let's get another year of games in Croke Park. And the games in Croker were no good last year.
That's exactly right. How have they have not learned from the games in Croker last year? They were all dead ducks. Like, no atmosphere, no buzz. And we're on about building this super rates like it's going to save the football, and then they bring them all to Croke Park where there's nobody there to see it and it's just dead. So yeah,
we like referees and umpires in the show.
We do, yeah. And we're talking about umpires. Certain umpires are making huge efforts in their right to get to the good position to make the right call, and we normally give out sometimes about refs and umpires, but we felt we had to give them some praise. Here we have the Crokes game, and you see this umpire trying to get to the right angle to see if the ball is going over the bar. And yeah, some people laughed. I was actually sitting at home with my wife Hillary and I said, fair play to him, got to the right position to make the right call. It would have been far easier for him to stand at the post like some of them do and not get the right call and miss it. And then obviously we had the incident with Tom O'Kane, the umpire during the Dublin Mayo game, and he got
all axed.
Yeah, he got poleaxed. He got poleaxed, but again was in the right area, and yeah, Tom was okay. And to see him being stretchered off was obviously a worrying sight here, because players at this level going at that speed, coming at anybody that would be standing there would be a scary one. But Tom was on the mend, and yeah, good to see him up and about again. But yeah, just to give him credit to, for one, for being brave, taking the hit, there's Tom's grand. So although he looks still a small bit weary in that photo, I'd say the bit of food and maybe a pint that night might have settled him down. But in fairness, we do give out sometimes, but I thought it was good on both counts.
Do you have a good relationship with the umpires when you're in full forward?
Like that, like both. You'd always go in and shake hands with them beforehand, and you know, there'd be times you'd be turning around, especially as a big full forward, any big full forwards, Michael Murphy, Aidan O'Shea, Tommy Welch, they all tell you that we get a bit more attention than smaller guys do. And there's the human nature, the aspect is, he's big enough, he'll look after himself. But like, you know, if you're getting pulled and dragged, you'd be turning around. But I always found it better to try and talk to them. But of course, there's times you snap at them too. But I had a very good umpire, I put it in my book, a guy called Dee Butcher, and I went to him before a game, and the fullback was giving me rabbit punches non-stop for the first 10 minutes. And I went into Dee, who was the stacks umpire, and there was the Tarbert umpire, and say, hey, what's calling the ref there? Like, the punch I'm getting is unreal. And Dee says, the next time he punches, swing your elbow as hard as you can. And I'll say, I saw nothing. And so yeah, I got punched, swung the elbow down, your man went, and there was pandemonium broke out, and the two umpires fighting behind the goals arguing. But yeah, so if there are umpires on your side, you've got a chance.
And you didn't get sent off, did you?
No. Dee said he didn't see anything. Perfect. There was a bit 50-50. Of boat in it. Yeah, 50-50, yeah.
One of the best stories from the last week has been the success of UCC in hurling and football. Not only do they have the best jersey, but it turns out now they've got the best teams in Sigerson and Fitzgibbon. One of the best stories of the Fitzgibbon Cup is Shane Conway, who is a Kerry hurler, who was one of the stars of the UCC team.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, you know, I talked to a few people about him over the last few days. I saw him at the county final last year. Absolutely unbelievable hurler. He had 14 points in the county final last year. You know, he got all the scores in the second half playing into Gale, like, and he was as brave as a lion for the size of him. And yeah, no, it was a great story, and great to see Kerry hurling in the spotlight, because they do a lot of good work down there. And Shane is obviously our star hurler down there. And yeah, we're delighted to have him on to talk about that Fitzgibbon Cup. And I suppose, Shane, what it felt like to actually win that medal, and for you, your family and your club?
Yeah, it was fantastic. It was just kind of a relief in Moncton's, because there was a lot of hype this year. We got to the league final, lost to DCU, and it was just a lot of hype going around saying that, oh, there's a great team here and they could win it. And then we played DCU in the semi-final, and it went to extra time, and it was a last-minute goal by one of our lads that snuck it in the finish. So the pressure for the Mayo game was, can we get our heads right and not to be listening around. So it was great that we did it, and there was a big gang, I think, from Alexander. They took a bus up. I think there was about 30-odd people there, so it was that bit more special that they were all there to see it.
That's class. Tell us a little bit about Lixnaw. So Galvin would have hurled for Lixnaw with you guys as well.
Yeah, he did. He played. No, I never played hurling with him. I was too young. But I can remember him playing right in 2014, and they won the county final that year as well. And he was a very good hurler, but he decided that he'd pick football, and he made a good name for himself, as he did out of it.
Hi, speaking about football, you're a tasty footballer yourself. We were in with Tommy Griffin and Peter Keane with the under-20s. Is it something that you'd ever consider?
I'm speaking with my football hat now. I didn't even really think about it, really. But yeah, I was in there for a small bit, alright. And my plan away is still with Fnug, and we're trying to get things going again there. We're kind of on a downhill at the moment, but hopefully we can bring it back open. But no, at the moment I'm very happy playing my hurling, and sure, we'll see what happens down the road. Who knows?
What was the crack like Tuesday night in Cardins?
we had great crack now, alright. We all went down to the Knaer as well, to the home place, and we got I think 26 fellas to go down, so they had a small bit of a shock to see that many people coming through the doors. But God, we were well behaved.
Nah, fair play. I think that's a nice touch from the team, and I suppose talking to Paul and his brother about you the last number of days, you know, you're held in very high esteem. I think one of them almost referenced that they'd that there were 14 minders minding you around the place there last year in the county final, that you were you were the go-to guy, obviously, but that you're, the way you play, you're brave, you go for everything, you take your man on, and I think, you know, if you get a bit of rough treatment in Kerry, I think you've probably a few fellas to jump in and look out for you in Lixna.
Yeah, definitely. The older players, they look after all of us, not just me, no, but all. We've a few young fellas that are after coming on that are maybe a year below me, and like you said, all the older fellas, if you're getting a nasty doing or anything like that,
which can happen in Kerry and Ireland, yeah.
They're very quick to jump in if one in all in. So no, they're very good like that, in fairness, to look after us. We'll just have to try and look after myself. No, it's always as well. We'll have to get a bit stronger or something.
No bother, but hit the gym.
Shane, good stuff. Thanks a million for joining us. Congratulations, man.
Yeah, hi, cheers. One second, Shane. Shane, I heard there's a doctor down in Lixna that might have two Sigerson Cup medals, so you're going to have to go get another one next year.
I'll have to try and get another one, yeah. I met him below Tuesday after the bring down.
He wasn't long taking your thunder.
He had
to
do him in his pocket to show me, so I'll have to catch him.
Yeah, all right, bye. Best luck next year and best luck for the rest of the season with Kerry going forward.
Cheers, thanks very much.
See, that's what I mean. That's exactly what happens. It's only in Kerry that you come home with a Fitzgibbon and be like, oh yeah, I'm the only one who's not even in a first division team. And it's like, oh, I've got two.
Yeah, he was taken down straight away. There's a doctor out there, Maris Fahy, who won two Sigerson's like 40 or 50 years ago. Not bad. But Shane couldn't even get 3 or 4 hours in this. That's Kerry for you. You're a few hours in the spotlight and you've got to get another one next year.
Praise makes you weak. Okay, we've got just 2 minutes left to make our big predictions for the weekend. I think you'll remember that I predicted accurately that Ireland would win a close game and only score 4 tries. What did you want? I said six tries,
yeah.
Hey, just remember, just in case, you know, the internet never lies. I don't remember the rest of my predictions, though.
I was about to say, okay, we'll come back to that.
I think Man United are going to win. So there against me, we're going to talk about that, but I want to predict that Tommy Walsh is going to start and star at full forward again. You know, long line of good full forwards in Kerry football. What do you make of this one?
Yeah, I'm impressed with Tommy in his two games so far. Great player, huge size. He's in serious, serious shape, physically wise. He had a tough the last 8 stages, but came out, won 3 big massive kickouts. We got 3 points off them, showed massive leadership. Tommy left in 2009 as a youngster who I was looking after my first 2 years. He was in the corner next to me. He was my brother's best friend. I was kind of arm around him, always minding him. And he went to Australia and he came back to us in 2015. And straight away inside in the dressing room, the way he spoke, the way he looked everybody in the eye, like he just changed from this kind of young fella to this serious man who was a serious leader in that team in 15. And it didn't work out for him that time, and it might have been a bit too soon. He found his form with his club really very much so last year. Back in with Kerry, and absolutely, like, you know, he could be a serious weapon for Kerry come the summer. Whether he starts or comes on is a big thing. I think he could actually be probably more dangerous coming on when one of our inside forwards has softened the guy up and tired someone out for 50 minutes. And I think Tommy's size and power could overturn somebody late on.
If the offensive mark comes in for a championship next year, he's also at that point going to
He's huge, and he won 2 or 3 of them the last day against Galway, leading out in front, like not necessarily the traditional high mark, but he's so good at getting out in front of people, and once he gets in front of you and gets a yard, you actually can't get around him, and he's so strong upper body that once he puts his hand out, he's grabbing the ball every time. So look, he's gonna have a big say in how Kerry do this summer, no doubt.
We're nearly out of time, but I want to do this one. Do Kerry need Cork the way Celtic need Rangers in football?
Yeah, they do. And look, as much as I've gone to war and gone at it with Cork fellas over the years, I actually don't want to see them where they are at the moment. Like, you know, Tipperary can bury the hatchet on them Saturday night. And
pretty much.
Yeah, look at putting them down to Division 3, which would be, you know, very tough. And, you know, it just makes Munster weaker. You know, that was always the game for me. You know, I always said that.
I don't believe a word of this. You're delighted. You can't.
No, honest to God, I'm not. Honest to God, I'm not. I don't have the bitterness streak in me. I told you last week when I was going to be hoping that the Crokes do well. So yeah, no, I hope Cork can somehow figure out a way to get out of it.
One last thing. The Hurling League has been ruined by the fact that the Hurling Championship has been fixed. And that's how it should be. The Hurling Championship is now a brilliant championship. All the matches matter. There's no coasting through to the latter stages the way there might have been in previous years. And as a result, the league is now just a warm-up.
Yeah, I would say a more feeling out process. You know, you talked about it earlier on, teams not wanting to show their hand. I'd say there's a good bit of that that goes on during the league from what I've seen from teams trying out fellas and making sure everybody gets a chance. And, you know, in hurling, the championship is unbelievable, and the league isn't what it's cracked up to be. And in the football, the league is absolutely the best tournament by a mile, and the championship isn't living up to what it's supposed to be. So there has to be a look at it from both sides.
Yeah, no, totally. And the law of unintended consequences. We see what happens when you run a championship properly. Kieran, good stuff. Episode 3 of the Shot Clock is in the books. You can email us, shotclock@offtheball.com. We'll see you next week.